attractive face things, yes.
Welcome back to Elevating the Genre. We are your co-hosts, Christopher Morrison and
Dominic.
Dominic's over there, and we are here to talk about all things that make smart, geeky stuff actually smart and geeky. And today we're going to talk about, we're going to unpack a tiny little corner of the existence that is Frank Miller. Just want to let you guys know that Dom and I had a long, thorough discussion about how the hell we were going to tackle this, and do know that we'll probably Mr. Miller's going to pop up again eventually, possibly in his own other second podcast, but we're going to focus pretty specifically this podcast a little bit more on his early career, his influence in comics in general, because there is a lot to unpack there.
Just to set up why it might be a two-parter is because Frank Miller is responsible for a lot of Daredevil, a lot of Wolverine, a lot of Batman, never mind Sin City and 300, which you might also have seen. So it's
And you can easily lay at his feet the whole direction the DC movie universe has taken in general. He broke into films with the RoboCop series and a whole bunch of – there's a lot to deal with, so we're not – just so you guys know.
It might be a two-parter, if not a trilogy.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe a trilogy. and there's lots of feels here as well for a lot of things. Mm. Anyway, jumping ahead a little bit. So our first little segment here on Elevating the Genre is always what's elevating our genre, where we talk about a little bit what Dom and I are sort of grooving and moving on in the geeky world. I think Dom started last time, so I'll jump in right now. I am going back to visit my love of I'm a big Asian cinemaphile, and for whatever reason I moved to Belgium and I sort of had to drifted away from it for a little while. Maybe not access to great Chinatowns and things like that. And I'm starting to ramp up on my first feature, and I really wanted this. I decided I really needed to go back and touch on some of my favorite Asian filmmakers, and I always settle on a Japanese gentleman by the name of Takashi Miike, for those that are in the know. For those that are not, he's fantastic, and he's just he is one of my artistic heroes, just because of how absolutely crazed and fearless he can be. And then when he wants to be, he can be a super formalist, which has turned out in his later career with his remake of Harakiri, 13 Assassins. A lot of his stuff is he's proven the naysayers wrong, let's say, in terms of people who thought he was just getting by on like absolutely ballsy, insane ideas and insane visuals, and literally in the middle of his career was making 7 or 8 movies, features, ladies and gentlemen, a fucking year. I just want to sort of throw that out there. If you have not moved and grooved on a little Takashi Miike, and most people have seen The Audition as him, but that is a tiny little portion of the wonderful genius that is trapped in that dude's head that he just sort of gets to let out all over us once in a while. So highly recommend that. I happened to watch today Gozu, which was a new one for me, which it's a wacky one. It's definitely – it's impossible not to say that this isn't his David Lynch film. It's very sort of fever dreamy, dream landscape-y kind of stuff. Even for Miike.
Is Takeshi Kitano in that one?
Oh yeah. No. Kitano's not it. No, it's a show. Oh, okay. Show.
I feel like I saw part of it, but I don't.
You might have. He works with Show Aikyo a lot, and he's in this. He's kind of brief. He's briefly in this, but I'm not necessarily recommending Gozu for people, but if you can check out Takashi Miike, he certainly elevates. Any genre he touches, some of his straight-up horror stuff is amazeballs. His comedies are funny and bizarre. His Yakuza movies are, sort of wide and varied, but even if you get sort of a normal, formal Yakuza movie out of Miike, it's always fantastic. And then you get his really weird Yakuza movies like the Dead or Alive trilogy. Like a Dragon has got some of my favorite, craziest performances of human beings ever put to film, and some of the best costume design you'll ever see. Anyway, Takashi Miike, check him out. Dom, what's going on? What's elevating your genre?
Yeah. Here. Go see one of Miike's 118 movies. I totally with you on that. And that dude is prolific. So on both counts, yeah, he wins a lot. Elevating my genre, I'm going to recommend again that people watch The Exorcist this Friday on Fox, if they can, because it's directed by our colleague and friend Jennifer Pong. And as far as elevating the genre, I'm like, I haven't watched enough Exorcist right now to decide whether it's like a great show or not a great show. But yeah, just cursory examination of the IMDb page. You know, it is a show that's pretty much run by men, written, directed, and all that stuff. And, you know, as many of them are. And I believe Jennifer's episode might be the only one in this first batch that's directed by a woman.
Wow.
And we can unpack that factoid in a lot of different ways. But the main way I was thinking about it was just, and again, this is with all respect to the original Exorcist as a film and an achievement. The Exorcist is a woman's story, or it could be a woman's story.
Absolutely.
It's not quite framed that way in
the original. Definitely not.
Because this is about the Exorcist and what he does.
Exactly, yeah.
But so if we're talking about sort of shifting paradigms or shifting just points of view on things, it's just, I'm excited to see a new take on Exorcist for that reason, because it's both
the person doing
the unpossessing, and it's the person being possessed, and they're...
And the mother, right? I mean, I'm blanking on who played her in the movie.
I can't remember either.
Ah, fudge, whatever. Anyway, you know, she gets some screen time, but yeah, no, clearly the and I haven't read the book either, so I don't know. I'm assuming they probably the book is called The Exorcist as well, so I assume it sort of focuses on Father. Well, I'm failing miserably today. Father, whatever his name is. Father.
Oh, I can't remember their names. Whatever.
The priest.
And I'm not sure that that's even relevant to the current TV.
Exactly,
But
okay, cool.
It might, but yeah.
Yeah, no, that's a great point, the idea that maybe they've shifted the story to focus on, or at least they certainly have time to spend with the Exorcist and the family.
I think they will have time in the series format, And as we all know, there's a long, interesting history of people casting demons out of women's bodies, and on different metaphorical levels. So I think it's good if they re-explore that. If you can, I'm certainly watching it this Friday, and let's check it out, and we'll discuss next week.
I'm gonna have to do a little fudging because it's not out in the old old Europe. But yes, I'll dig it up and check it out.
However, you get the American Fox TV over there.
Yeah, I'm right.
Anyway, okay.
No worries. Now, usually, ladies and gentlemen, we'd be going into the next segment, which would be Morrison's Mistakes, our errata segment. But we're trying really hard to give this wonderful content to you in about 60 minutes worth of time. So something had to go. And since I make a shit ton of mistakes, you will find the errata, the wonderful mistakes that I made now on the WordPress blog for Elevating the Genre. Check it out. It's over there. All the mistakes will be written out for you. We're not going to go over it any longer. So we're just going to jump right into it.
And feel free to dialogue us in the comments or messages about mistakes, because we're not trying to say like we know every single thing and get right. We're just saying what's in our heads usually. So so we would love that kind of dialogue from listeners.
Absolutely. Dom and I are definitely, we're not positioning ourselves as experts, we're just positioning ourselves as creators and lovers of the stuff, and just also lovers of the unpacking the stuff. Let us know what we get wrong, and let us know what we get right, and we'd love to hear from y'all always. So, okay, here we go. Pushing the boulder down the hill to get this rolling. Mr. Frank Miller, for those who don't know, really, really quick, Frank Miller is credited with sort of him, a little guy named Alan Moore. Possibly you could throw Grant Morrison on that heap, or sort of quote-unquote responsible for creating, bringing comics into the 90s or bringing comics into the late 80s, early 90s, into giving comics a certain modern sensibility. Chris Claremont does it a little bit earlier in a certain very specific way with the Uncanny X-Men, which we talked about in episode 1. Here we are at episode 7, sort of also unpacking sort of something that happens a little bit as Chris is transitioning his work in the Uncanny X-Men. So Frank Miller is a comic book artist and writer who drops into Marvel's circuit first, but then equally bounces between Marvel and DC, touching and in much like Chris Claremont did with the X-Men, taking a third tier book and making it a first tier book. Miller does that with Daredevil, shows up on the Wolverine miniseries with Chris Claremont, then blows open the doors with Dark Knight. The first one does what I think is some of his best work in a little book called Ronin, which we're probably not even going to get a chance to talk about. Another piece of my favorite is with Jeff Darrow, who is the guy that's going to go on to create the look of the production design of The Matrix, with a little book called Hard Boiled, which is another one of my hidden favorites.
Both those are great.
Yeah, and then Miller drops an amazing 4-issue run for Dark Horse called Give Me Liberty as well. And then a little thing called 300 comes along, and then he starts to really lose his mind, and we get things like Holy Terror and certain versions of Sin City. Personal note there. Anyway, and then, of course, he vaults in and out of Hollywood, starting with RoboCop 2 and 3, and then, if you don't know, Sin City is based on his Sin City books. He did a movie called The Spirit, which I never bothered to see, which is based on Will Eisner's work, blah, blah, blah. He's kind of everywhere, and he definitely gets, deservedly so, gets an enormous amount of credit for, you know, you hate to say modernizing comics, but he brings a certain modern sensibility to comic books that are in the doldrums in the 70s little bit. So that being said, like I said, Dom and I are going to spend the rest of this time kicking around this really early history of him with his mainstream books, particularly, let's start with the man himself, Daredevil, shall we? Also, because obviously hopefully that's a little bit relevant to a lot of our audience. Perhaps you guys have seen the Marvel Netflix show. And even if you did see the absolute tragedy that is the Mark Steven Johnson, Ben Affleck shit show, Daredevil, my personal opinion, guys, that is also massively influenced from...
that wasn't around. As bad as the first Elektra movie. That's just what I'm going to say.
I skipped the first Elektra movie intentionally.
First Elektra movie makes the first Daredevil movie look like the freaking Godfather.
It's directed by the same goofball. So whatever. And I think that's his name, Mark Steven Johnson. I really hope that guy just freaking has crawled under a rock and is never showing his face ever again. But anyway. So let's talk about what is your take on sort of Miller's early Daredevil stuff? Like, where do you sit on it?
Well, I mean, I looked it up a little bit this week, and first he was an artist, and he brought his always distinctive, always amazing visual style to first, and he was probably learning to be a comics writer or the kind of writer he was going to be at this time. Am I correct in this? Out of those three you mentioned, that like the really important writers in recent comics history, is he the only one who is an artist who transitions into being a writer?
Because that's a good question. Yeah, absolutely. Moore is just a writer. I don't think he's ever drawn anything, and I know Grant. I don't think Grant Morrison's ever drawn a thing in his life. Yeah, I don't think so. Early Grant Morrison did, I think. I think he's like credited with like two things really, really early on. It wasn't even for 2000 AD, but yeah, no, basically, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. No, you're right. You're absolutely right.
And I mean, in those cases, let's be fair. Frank Miller is a superhuman comics artist. Okay, that was an easy choice of words. He is an amazing comics artist. He's absolutely one of the top tier comic artists ever. His visual sense, framing, use of just high contrast imagery, body language, incredible shit.
And for me, his art, what's great about even the early Daredevil stuff, because sometimes you look at his stuff and you're like, this is all out of proportion and this is all a little weird, and like they've got muscles that don't exist, and not in a weird Rob Liefeld sort of way, just in this weird, he does it for perspective, he does it for an intention, and I think he's just always been interested from the very beginning of not that what eventually is going to become sort of the Jim Lee super slick, you know, hyper realism. He was always interested in being like, no, this is, there's a distance here. And again, and that, and in his hands, it always worked for his, for the tone that he was establishing as well. I don't know, for me.
Right. So that was kind of my lead into this, looking into those Daredevils before he starts writing it. I think there was some writers where he was working with, you know, Dennis O'Neill, who is another, you know, classic comics writer. But yeah, it was more in the mode of, you know, the old comics.
Yep.
And then eventually he starts doing the writing, and another artist comes in, David Mazzucchelli.
Right.
To do this series called Born Again, which is... Let's say if there are comics I've read 1,000 times in my lifetime, Born Again is one of them.
Oh wow!
The Daredevil Born Again arc is one of them.
Okay,
I have it in a battered trade paperback. It's falling apart. I've read 1,000 times. Also, Watchmen, Dark Knight. Well,
gotcha. Just so people know, the Born Again series is sort of Frank Miller going back to Daredevil after he'd written on the monthly book, right, and sort of reestablishing his origin story. Am I crazy?
Oh right. Well, you know what? I mean, we'd have to look that up exactly. Definitely,
okay.
He's gone.
Right.
He comes back and forth to it.
You're right.
And I was just trying to make the point that he definitely started as an artist and definitely making his mark as a visual stylist that probably made Daredevil much cooler than he was before. Because he's,
true.
I mean,
true that,
one thing,
true
I,
that.
I mean, he's...
I mean,
he's,
John Romita isn't I think Senior's on the, well, on the very original book. I think Junior eventually takes over that book. He's nobody to sneeze at, right?
Oh, no, I love him. But I think when his reboot of the origin story is after Born Again.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay.
We may be mixing up our years here.
That's right. Okay. No, his reboot of the origin story is just Daredevil, the Man Without Fear. Is that right? I can't remember.
Yeah,
anyway,
I think so.
Okay,
and this is what...
My bad.
I have that cool Marvel Unlimited pass for a couple more weeks where you get the thumb through their archives on this iPad.
Oh.
So believe me, it's fucking great for thinking, organizing years in your head. You can actually sort by year and search by creator and just see like all the books they did over the years.
Holy
shit, boss. Miller was here in Daredevil 3, and then he went over here, then he went over here.
It's, wow.
I mean, you know, for archive... this librarian sort of level comics nerds like us, it's fascinating. Anyway, so we're gonna, again, please everyone correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, please.
But for me, the thing is, you know, he was born to draw Daredevil. I mean, Daredevil's a guy in a typing suit slinking around on these dark urban landscapes fighting other guys who slink around only on rooftops. And ninjas, a lot of ninjas
eventually,
and just there's a poetry to how he draws the human form that's just like you know the super acrobat,
and that's the perfect word, man. Poetry is great. His distortion of the human body, because again, like a lot of people can sort of laugh at like meat hands or whatever, or like super extendo Lego, but it is there's a poetry to it. It fits a worldview. It fits a tone. That is just Frank Miller. Yeah.
Yeah, totally. And right. And when and I believe also in this run leading up to him taking over writing at Born Again, one thing that's notable is Daredevil's like the only guy in a costume for like 10 issues.
Right.
He's mainly fighting, you know, gangsters, guys in suits, guys who may there's a sort of incongruous gladiator that shows up, but it's not like, you know, we're guest starring, you know, right. Plasma, the Wonder Mutant this month.
Yeah, right.
He's mainly dealing with real people. He's the only guy in a costume, and the costume totally works the way Frank was drawing. So then when we get into Born Again, you know, we again kind of a really nice, what's the word, deconstruction of a superhero story. Just very briefly, it's the one where the Kingpin finds out Daredevil's secret identity, and uses the Kingpin's, you know, real world influences to destroy Matt Murdock as a person in the world.
Right.
You know, destroy him financially, destroy his identity, so that the only thing he has left is this superheroic alter ego who has no tax ID.
Right.
And Daredevil goes down. He loses his fancy lawyer life, basically. Mm-hmm. And he goes down into the dregs of Hell's Kitchen and just has to bring himself up again. And towards the end of it, we have people in masks again, Captain America mm-hmm. and Nuke also show up. And but it's like it's a wonderful story and borrowed a lot from in the mm-hmm. Daredevil Netflix series here and there.
Right. Absolutely. And I mean, that's the other thing is that he does, I mean, Frank Miller also spent, I mean, not to the extent the Netflix series does, but they definitely take their cue from this run about humanizing the Kingpin a little bit. Not the point.
Yeah.
Miller certainly doesn't give him a love interest or anything like that, but at least not that I recall off the top of my head. But you spend more time with the guy and you enjoy watching him get a chance to get back at Matt Murdock and all of that good stuff. And it definitely humanizes what up to that point, at least from my memory, was just sort of he was a generic Spider-Man villain, Daredevil villain who was a really big fat dude who could take a punch and like didn't really manipulate mm-hmm. didn't. And if I'm not mistaken, it's a one of the other things is there's the real estate scam in that arc too, or is that in the that's also maybe later. I can't remember.
I think there've been a couple.
A couple, yeah, right.
Those kind of. Because they're always trying to gentrify Hell's Kitchen somehow.
Right, exactly.
So there's some. There have been a couple variations of that. Definitely comes up in the end.
Right. I mean, it's just
of Born Again.
Right. I mean, so that makes the Kingpin kind of a smart villain, right? He's not like. Again, he's not Doctor Doom. He's not building some secret weapon to take over the world or whatever. He's not accessing some other dimension. He's actually using real world angles. And I think this is also comes directly from Frank Miller's, you know, very blatant, obvious influence from dragging film noir into comics as well. I mean, that's mm-hmm. just
yeah.
what he's pulling from. It happens to be what he's interested in. And again, if you leap forward in this dude's career by 20 years and you hit Sin City, then it's really insane. It's really, you know, obviously Sin City would not exist without noir. But really, if you crack open those early Daredevils, I don't think this take on Daredevil would exist without noir either. To some extent. Yeah.
Absolutely. No, there's a lot of guys in hats.
And the real estate scam stuff is directly out of noir, is a very Chinatown-esque sort of villain, right? Yes, and one of the things that Matt Murdock tends to do under Frank Miller also is go up against establishment, right? Like, he's a lawyer, so he's part of the establishment, but he's always kind of fighting against the establishment as well, which we will see in Frank Miller, a very intense theme that goes through a lot of his work maybe later in his career, maybe to his own detriment. But again, it just grounds Daredevil in such a wonderful way, and I think in a way that probably didn't happen, and again, obviously I wasn't around for the early Spider-Man books, but, you know, Spider-Man benefits from being set in New York and having real world problems. Mm-hmm. And I think Frank Miller's run on Daredevil, although eventually it falls into ninjas and craziness as well, which doesn't fall into it. It transitions there quite nicely through the introduction of Elektra. Again, mm-hmm. it's, which is great because again, in comics at that time, most other writers would have just been like, and now ninjas, like literally the next issue would just mm-hmm. be like, and now there were mm-hmm. ninjas. But, Elektra sort of drags that world in, which is lovely. I don't know.
Elektra, the Greek ninja, by the way.
Greek ninja.
I love that.
Yeah, it's cool. That is true. I never thought about that. The Greek ninja. Yeah. So let's talk about Elektra. Let's jump over to that character because she is, again, sort of one of the few iconic female characters, and for a while she was on the down low. I mean, she was way below Wonder Woman, she was way below any of the X-Men females, way below a bunch of other characters. Now she's getting, I think, her due a little bit more. Obviously she got her own she's one of the few characters. I mean, became mm-hmm. so important. Is she the first one to first female comic book
in the Marvel
feature?
Netflix?
Yeah, certainly Marvel. No,
oh,
no,
get
no.
A feature?
Oh,
you know what? Yeah, that's a funny thing. Sometimes people are like, Marvel never has any woman characters, which, by the way, I have personal beef with because that's just people talking who don't really know.
Right. It's an easy. But, it's a shorthand. Yeah.
Yeah, we understand about representation of women in those superhero movies, but Marvel has tons of really awesome female characters. They just aren't doing them all the time. And yes, people forget that Elektra had her own movie.
Yeah, right.
So, I think she was probably the first. So don't even try to say that they never even tried.
Right, exactly.
They did try.
They did try, but they put it in the wrong dude's hands, probably, and I don't know who the hell the writer is or was, but now Elektra's definitely, you know, easily a top tier Marvel character. I would say. And then Miller obviously introduces her into the comic. Is there anything you want to say about her appearance in Daredevil?
Well, she's not obviously Greek. It's an interesting thing. I think I blogged about this at Yom Yom F, and she's played by a mixed person of some Asian heritage, and it's an interesting thing. I prefer her a lot to Jennifer Garner. I'll say that. we can move past it as a because it is look upable on Yom Yom F, and we can move to the next point as I summon whatever my point would have been.
All right, no worries. What I think I want to get into next is I do want to just the super team that is Frank Miller and Chris Claremont getting together to jump onto the Wolverine miniseries also happens to be super important in my life. I was not collecting when it was dropping as individual books, but I will brag. I picked those books up for like $5 a piece in back issue bin, so it was really close to when I started collecting. So, I think I remember feeling the pain when I doled out $10 for Wolverine number one. So I bought 3 copies. But anyway. And so again, little context for people that don't know: Chris Claremont was the writer responsible for the Uncanny X-Men run. Was responsible for basically. Bringing Wolverine into the position that he was as a top tier character, and Marvel at the time, miniseries were still pretty rare, and they decided it was time for a Wolverine miniseries. And Chris Claremont got pulled in Frank Miller because he was the hot artist right now. He had elevated Daredevil to one of the best selling books. He came in and he didn't just come on as a penciler for the Wolverine miniseries. He's credited as a co-plotter. As well. So you don't get that book without Miller's major input. And as far as I'm concerned, I think it's the thing that you could say Uncanny X-Men issue 133, sorry, deep baseball here, guys, which is the first solo Wolverine story in the Dark Phoenix saga, really puts Wolverine on the map, but it's the Wolverine miniseries that makes everybody lose their shit. And makes everyone go, this is the coolest cat on the block. And that is all Miller. I mean, just those 4 covers are so iconic and so posterized and have been so posterized for so long.
That third one where he's sad and looking.
I know, and it's fantastic.
I was just looking at that today.
Yeah, the bright blue background and the freaking complete negative fill on his face. You barely see his face, and he's sad. Yeah. But I mean, the first issue of just like the fist and the claws and the come hit and the fucking grin and the freaking cocked finger is iconic Wolverine. Like it is the image that is burned into people's minds. And again, Miller gets to play with more ninjas in the hand and everything else. But that storyline is so wonderfully sensitive to the crazy violence that's in it. Wolverine having a true real love interest that he gets to go pursue. We unpack the background of Wolverine's Japanese influence and storyline. And you get the first image of Wolverine bent over with 90 arrows stuck out of his back. I mean,
right.
I'm sorry. If you don't like that panel, like, you don't like comics. Like, you don't, like, you just don't. And which is completely, and again, which is
completely. I think my mom didn't like that panel.
Well, screw your mom. And that panel is so iconic, they rip it out and they put it in the goddamn second Wolverine movie. Is it the second Wolverine movie? Yeah, whatever. Yeah, it's in the second. I mean, it's that it's in silhouette.
That's
in the,
what Wolverine does. He absorbs a lot of punishment.
A lot of punishment, and particularly
Miller kind of like, yeah.
Yeah, and he makes it the prettiest punishment that you can get. I don't know. Do you have any experience with that miniseries? How did it sort of come into your life?
Oh, I read that one 1,000 times too. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to summon all the best parts. I mean, the panels with the sword fighting mm-hmm. with the old Nasser dude.
Yeah.
I think I could just watch those. I could just look at those panels all day. And yeah. Again, this is about his, you know, his work as an artist, which synergizes with his later work with as a writer in you know, definitively comics way, which then wonderfully goes to movies because he's laid it all out. But yeah, it's just everything, like the sense of motion, and you know, he was good at these things. Like Wolverine is a character that you can identify from his silhouette, and you don't have to read his face, which is another definitively comics thing.
Right.
So he just had a wonderful command of setting up drama and being able to look at things from different angles. Oh, God. I know, just the sword battles. I just, you know, again, if I could have them just postered up on my wall, I would do that. Do you know what I'm saying? Do you know, just like the
of
look
course,
at the,
man. No,
of wanna, how their arms are.
Arms,
and like,
yeah, and the way they. He's got the
I
best.
I can see what they're about to do and what they just did somehow in
rock and
a
roll,
still
yeah.
panel.
Yeah. No, it's crazy. It's got some beautiful moment. And for those that don't know, Frank did study some Iato. So he that's the other reason it maybe feels grounded. He's not making things up. But speaking of sword plays and panels, I'm going to jump real quick into Ronin just for 2 seconds, just because one of my
sure.
favorite writing moments and one of my favorite panels is. I'm not even going to bother to tell you the story of Ronin, but basically our main character, is a Japanese guy who wields katanas and whatever. Happy, happy days. And he has a ridiculous sort of film moment where he throws his katana through a guy, right? He literally throws his sword through a guy. In the meantime, his master, who he's defending, is standing right there and goes, "You idiot, why did you just throw your weapon away?" But the dude's in this badass, like, arm out pose that's in silhouette, and it's in the same panel. So this is Miller, and again, this is a little before the meta thing really kicks in hard. So it's in the same panel, so it's genius. And then the dude's the next panel is the dude is suffering the consequences of not having his weapon, and then just calmly has a line of, "Well, it's a good thing for both of us, master, that you have yours." So, and it's just nice. It's a nice, great moment. Right. So the master has to pull his blade and go kick some ass as well. So.
And is Ronin one of the first ones he wrote and illustrated all himself? He autored, so to speak.
Yeah.
Did he write that?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, that's all okay. him, and it's a freaking 12. You know what they used to call the maxi
yeah.
series, if you remember.
The maxi
DC,
series.
The maxi series that he did for DC. He did that way before anything else. I don't know its relationship to Wolverine, but I'm almost positive it came out after. I think Wolverine's like 84, and I think Ronin is 86. Yes, ladies and gentlemen, I'm scanning my shelf. I should have done this earlier to see if I can find my Ronin. But anyway, anywho, yeah, just
I mean,
a lovely moment.
Yeah, the exact timing of it maybe is not so important, but I was interested in sort of tracking when he went from mainly artist to writer and artist, and then sometimes
well,
just
to writer artist pretty quick on Daredevil, right? Because he lobbied to get on that book. I think he only drew like five. He only drew five before they started letting him write some stuff. It's pretty quick, actually.
Maybe they just stand out really well in my mind.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, I mean, there's no reason not to. I mean, they're kind of crazy good. So from here, from Wolverine and that miniseries is a smash success. And one of the first that I remember. Graphic novels getting bundled together and sold as a thing, right? Because again, we all have to remember graphic novels back in the day were.
Who would have thought?
Yeah, right. We're actually Marvel's had a separate line of things called graphic novels, which were standalone series that were kind of this weird transition between Marvel and Epic Comics. I won't go into that shit too much detail, but they were original stories. So,
but they were called Epic, by the way, before
yes,
that
Epic.
Was a thing.
Exactly. They were fucking called Epic, right? Figure it out, ladies and gentlemen. So the idea, you know, this, there wasn't this idea that you take comics that were published and band them together and just resell them as graphic novels. But Wolverine miniseries was so popular that was one of the first ones that I recall being banded together and sold. There you go. Anyway, so
yeah, and somewhere in this time, people were debating, well, you know, we're trying to brand graphic novels as a thing to get away from the stigma of comics, and people are saying things like graphic literature all the time, and, and that was an interesting time. And I think it resolved back to, you know, it's okay to say the word comics again, but remember for a while it was like,
oh,
I'm a graphic novelist.
Yeah.
Graphic novel.
Yeah, I'm writing a graphic novel. Yes, that came. Right. I remember that phrase dropping out of some douchey mouths. Yeah. So Wolverine hits hard, and then he goes over to DC for a little while. Comes with Ronin. Comes back for a prestige book, Elektra Assassin. Right.
Yes.
Which is a fully painted book, if I'm not mistaken, because I will be honest with everybody. I haven't read it. So, Dom, this one's over to you again. If you can fill us in a little bit on the Elektra Assassin lovely run.
Yeah, Elektra Assassin is a good one, folks. Yes, the art is credited to Bill Sienkiewicz, who was a guy who used to draw people sort of normal comic book way. And then he got the idea, I'm going to do very impressionistic paintings in the comic book format. And I'll be honest, I was not down with it as a little kid at first.
Right.
When I picked up that New Mutants book, I was like,
what
is this? For a while, I couldn't follow it.
Right.
Also, I'm bad in museums with paintings, whatever. but it just turns out that art is incredible. It's just not the standard way that things are drawn in comic books at the time.
Right.
Or
ever, or still, really. I mean, Sienkiewicz is his own dude.
It's very painterly. It's sometimes very gross and edgy and, dreamscape horrific.
Totally.
But it's still, in its way, abides by the rules of comics. It has...
Yeah, very much it, so. No, yeah, yes, he's very much... He's
heroes and monsters and...
For me, he's a comics painter. I mean, that's just sort of the way I think of him.
So, yeah. Bill Sienkiewicz. Fascinating dude. But anyway, so Elektra Assassin is a big deal for me for a couple of reasons. Mm. One, it's a very political story, and eventually we'll get into Miller's politics. And by the way, we're voting for an American president next week, so this stuff is on my mind.
Woohoo!
So the very basically the story premise of Elektra Assassin is that there is a presidential election happening, and the two candidates are, one guy is basically Ronald Reagan.
Yeah.
Remember Miller had his fun with Reagan in Dark Knight.
Right.
He's also,
and Thatcher.
He has a version of that dude, of that president guy in Elektra Assassin. And he's similar. He's just a little troll, a little monster with his finger on the nuclear missiles button, and he's just written like a mean, bitter, petty little golem, basically. So he's a caricature of the crazy right wing president, caricature of who Trump would be, blah blah blah. But the opposing candidate is this guy who we would call super liberal.
Mm.
His name's Ken Wind, and he's the one who is like all PC, like the people, the minorities, we're all together in the ocean. He's doing a caricature of the liberal left point of view. These are just like political cartoonist characters. And to be fair, he's drawn like Donald Trump. So the funny thing that happens is while the incumbent Reaganite right winger is in the White House, Ken Wind, his opponent, who looks like he's going to win, is actually possessed by the beast from the hand.
Oh shit! Okay.
So it turns out that it turns into a no-win scenario for the American people. You've either got the little troll Reagan, or you've got an ostensible liberal who is actually possessed by a demonic beast that wants to end all humanity.
All right.
So who are you going to call in this situation? Elektra does show, and she teams up with this buffoonish S.H.I.E.L.D. agent, like not the S.H.I.E.L.D. agent you've seen in any other series, the hard drinking, like bad mustache, really lumpy, lazy fucker of a S.H.I.E.L.D. agent. And they have this funny thing, and they just have to get in the middle of this and basically chop some heads.
There you go.
So I'll return to it as I remember all the things. But the other thing I want to point out is that from a writing storytelling standpoint, is when we talk about how comics shifted into a more, you know, modern narrative. Mm-hmm. He's doing a lot of that in mm-hmm. Elektra Assassin, also Daredevil, mm-hmm. with like a more decentralized kind of writing style, like mm-hmm. sentence fragments, kind of stream of consciousness, multiple point of views, all mm-hmm. talking the same panel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I think one of the things we associate with old comics is like it has sort of corny speechifying.
Sure, absolutely.
Yeah, like some people would go on like speeches that just sounded like way too composed, and you couldn't they didn't sound like real people.
Right.
Miller, Alan Moore did the other thing of he just made those speeches a lot more pretty.
Yes, right, which is a whole other issue. Yeah, right, totally. Right.
But
totally another way
I
to address that
Miller
issue,
right? Starts to, and he probably gets to do this because he was such a great visual artist. He managed to get the images to play off the words in a kind of very, very much more sensory way, just like all these different ideas and points of view coming in at once, and they all somehow collaborate an image. So, you know, I can't say that Elektra utters like a whole full sentence for a couple of those issues.
I mean, for me, that's coming directly from his film noir influence, right? Like, noir has this beautiful, you know, whatever, I can't remember where I read this or whatever, but there's sort of, you know, film noir has been credited, the dialogue has been credited as sort of the poetry of the street kind of a deal from that time period. And obviously a hyper-idealized version of that, right? But like
a kind of gruff speak.
It's a gruff speak, but it also can be, you know, you read some Dashiell Hammett or you read some of that stuff or you watch some of those movies and it is highly composed and sometimes, you know, almost can sound like a foreign language. But you also get it juxtaposed right up against the like the monosyllables and the grunts and the and all that stuff, which is what I think one of the stronger appeals for film noir is not just the visuals, but the language is so identifiable and has a poetic. It's got the sort of the poetry of the street thing, and I think Miller's pulling directly from that and is very bloody good at it, especially in the early, again, jumping ahead here, but early Sin Cities, he's got it in spades, which makes it impossible to read in fucking French, by the way, which was the first French comic I tried to read. Was the first Sin City book in French. Impossible to understand because it's fucking film noir French, and it was a dumb idea. So for those that are curious and think that, oh, I know, I'll learn another language by reading fucking City, don't do it. Although I'd be fascinated to see someone trying to learn Japanese through film noir Japanese.
Oh my god, yeah. There was a funny. There was a meme. I won't go into it right now, but yeah, humor often does not translate between languages.
Yeah, just to
and just style and tone. And a caveat on the Sin City thing. He does go back to the speechifying at some point, to a fault. So I will say that some crazy, wacky kids in UCLA theater school did a stage version of Dame to Kill For once.
Oh, my word.
More or less verbatim. And I'll say,
oh my god, that's awesome.
Despite their obvious production challenges, one thing was that dialogue doesn't sound that great spoken
out loud.
Well, so maybe in the Sin City movie you can see this too.
Shocker.
It sounds a little weird.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway. So he's not perfect, but I just wanted to mention that about writing.
There you go, writing and stuff. All right, so we've avoided it long enough. We have to get to the elephant in the – well, there's lots of elephants in this room, but we'll get to the first elephant in the room, which is The Dark Knight Returns, which lands – Miller goes – leaves Marvel, is wooed away from Marvel to DC, and again, DC allows him to do – prestige book and hands him the keys to Batman, and his pitch is And I think they really do it because his pitch is so out of continuity, and sort of so just like rockets him into the future and blah, blah, blah. Mm. Really, people, if you don't know, you all know the Dark Knight story. It's fine. Trust me. If you basically know it by piecing together all the movie elements that are out there that are based on it. We're not going to get into the story of it. You could also say that, you know, even some version of Heath Ledger's Joker, I think, is taken directly from some of this writing. It's clearly influenced, blah, blah, blah. Dom and I think, we were talking earlier before we started, I think this is a good place to start talking about where Miller really transitions hard into lobbying. It's so political, right? Obviously, what you just heard from Electra Assassin is massively political, but this is the spine of this book. Is the politics between Batman and Superman and just establishment versus a dude who thinks he knows what's right happens to have the ability to just go out and do the thing he thinks is right. And of course, particularly in The Dark Knight Returns, we kind of want him to do what's right because pretty much everybody else is fairly horrible. Even Superman, to some extent, has gone so in such a direction that we want Batman to go whoop his ass a bit to, quote-unquote, I don't know, restore balance. Not that balance is ever mentioned in those books. so, I don't know. What's your sort of feelings about the positioning of the book as a sort of a really 30,000-foot level view?
Yeah, I mean, I read that one 1,000 times, too. Mm-hmm. I wanted to say this earlier, we have seen it in the Nolan films and a lot in Batman vs Superman. This is one of those things, like, if for the Sin City movie, you know, Rodriguez went out of his way to credit, maybe to a fault, overcredit Miller, but at least say, like, this was the book he came up with that.
Right.
And the Dark Knight trilogy that everyone loved so much. That was mainly a lot Frank Miller's work, and I don't think he got full credit for that. It's funny, kind of like in Batman versus Superman, they go so far as, okay, we're just using exact lines of dialogue,
right? And he apparently was even, I can't remember, does he get an on-screen credit for that? I know he was actually on the red carpet for the premiere for sure.
Perhaps he's but that was an interesting case of like, just backtrack a little bit. For me, I'm going to say the unpopular thing. I think Nolan's Dark Knight movies are a little overrated.
Fair enough. I hate the third one.
Yeah, the third. They're bloated. They're bloated with way too much shit.
Yeah.
And when I scrape away all the other shit and find the stuff that still keeps me in the movie, I find coincidentally it's something that happened in Dark Knight. or in one of Miller's Batman comics. So it's like, you took the cream and then you added some other shit, and the cream still stands out, and the cream was made by this guy.
Right, exactly.
And Batman vs Superman bloated in a totally different way, just hyper bloated.
So there's only there.
So I loved it. And as a fan, I loved seeing that stuff. I just love seeing the Miller stuff come to life in both the Nolan movies and even in Batman vs Superman. Mm-hmm. You know, I geeked out when he's speaking to Batman about you know, this year, my parents taught me a different lesson.
Yeah.
Dying in the street or however he talks.
So what's your take on the Dark Knight comics? I mean, in
the comic.
Yeah.
It was hard to read the first 100 times.
Right.
I got over it.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
Again, all the different points of view. There are still panels I still don't know what's going on. Do you find that?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. Definitely.
Okay, it's an extremely dense piece.
It is very dense.
And when you think about like the number of panels one is conventionally supposed to put on the comic page, you start seeing this thing where it's basically like 16 or 24 little tiny panels showing bits of television information, sometimes showing nothing and just people talking off camera, which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
And it's one of those works that keeps on giving, like a good work of literature, because I'll come back to it and flip open pages like, oh, you know what? I really don't know what this panel was even about.
Yeah.
But it all contributed to a gigantic quilt story of Gotham City in
right.
in a hellhole, and bring it to an apocalypse.
Yeah, and it just is, and I think also you can't overstate Lynn Varley, I believe how pronounced her last name, right? The color palette of that book is so beautifully muted and crazily 80s, used in the right way, and still evokes. I mean, it may be the only thing I can say is a true 80s noir piece, like that manages to still be 80s and still be 110% noir. I can't even think of a movie
I didn't think about it that
does. It's what hits me. Like, what's amazing about the art and the film, and especially the panels you're talking about with the TV. There's a couple of crazy TV presenters that always pop up, and the woman has got this perfect 80s shock of orange crazy hair that literally goes in three different points. That's clearly supposed to be sort of future, but really it's just it's a character that could only have been drawn in like 86 or 87 or 88.
Right.
It's the same thing when you watch some 80s movie and the punks come on the bus with the person with the 8 foot mohawk. You know, like those people, there were a couple of those people walking the streets, but you would think if you watched 80s TV and 80s movies that they were fucking everywhere, and they were not. They were pretty fucking rare.
One posted on every block.
Yeah, exactly right. So
it's a signifier.
It's a signifier. But anyway, but it just is. That tone is incredible. And what again? Yes, no. One of the, I remember struggling. Yeah, every time one of those pages would show up where it was the TV. I remember being like, the first couple of times reading it, being like, no, I'm not gonna skip this page. I'm gonna fucking try to soak every little stupid panel in. I remember fucking. I think I counted one time. I think there is a page that has 24 or 26. Panels on one fucking page, but it all contributes, man. Like that TV stuff. Mm-hmm. When you get the joke, when the Joker shows up in the TV audience room or whatever that is, where he's on TV, and you're finally in the studio after being, I don't know. There's something about the way the Joker is drawn that actually fucking reminds me of those tiny little panels, and there's just such an artistic through line. That's just, I don't know. It's hard to overstate how overwhelmingly complete that piece is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's kind of doing a filmic thing. I mean, whether, you know, just subconsciously in a savant way or not, he's just clicking through, making little cuts to guide your eye to, you know, without being as cheesy as far out zooming in.
Right.
He kind of sneaks up on the character and like, oh, there he is. Maybe this was just his boot for a second. And you're like,
And for me, the crazy use of perspective in this book, and when he decides to just go absolute balls out nutso with it, again, was confusing the first time I read it, coming from like the Dave Cockrum Uncanny X-Men stuff, or, you know, the Romita father and son team kind of played with perspective a little bit as well, but nowhere near to the extent that Miller does. And I was just unprepared to open that book and just be smacked in the face with it. And it was, and yeah, I'll admit, the first time I read it, I was like, it was super distracting. I was like, I think finishing the book and being like, my first impression was TV screens, giant hands, dead Joker. What just happened? Like, I could process. Oh, and one-armed Green Arrow, because Green Arrow was my entrance to DC Comics. So, yeah.
Okay, well, yeah. That was a lot you just said, Christopher.
That was my literally. I'm almost positive that was the series. And even in that order, like TV screens, giant fists, dead Joker, one-armed Green Arrow, like in that order.
Really the best use of Green Arrow. It's one of my favorite Green Arrows ever.
112%. Like, it is such a logical extension of where that dude ends up.
Right. If there's one thing they could have fucking just Easter egged us with any of these
Batman
movies.
I was begging for that. You have no idea. I was on my knees. I was like, maybe in Batman vs. Superman, even because they're not fucking using him for fucking Justice League. Just stick him in as an old man with one fucking arm pulling the fucking bow with his teeth. I'd be so stoked.
Yeah, they don't even call him Green Arrow ever in Dark Knight Returns, the comic, too. That's what's so awesome. We just So many awesome things.
Yeah, no, it's fantastic. Now, however, we do, I think I want to definitely address before we move away from it. Well, maybe we could actually, let's just go ahead and jump into issues, because I know issues are going to be weird. But this is also, like, you can't escape from the idea in this book that, like, Batman is just a dude who's like, nope, I know what's best for everybody. Fuck off, I'm going to go do it. I'm going to go take out Superman. I'm going to go murder a bunch of teenage thugs and convert them to my... Eventually convert them, become Christ for a bunch of teenage thugs after I murder a whole pile of them. And sort of quote unquote, I'm gonna use a terrible phrase here, man up and kill the Joker finally, and go take out Superman. Like, there is, you just, I don't know, for me, one of the issues that makes me feel a little icky is that you just can't get away from the total Batman libertarian streak that runs through the DK1. I mean, you can't.
Yeah, totally.
Okay. I'm not alone on this hill.
No, it's a well-established thread that Batman is kind of a weird super libertarian cartoon. Mm-hmm. And how you feel about that gauges how you feel about Batman in a lot of cases. But I just love the way you summed up those things he does. It sounded that way a lot like old Batman's bucket list.
Check.
It's like old crotchety Batman's gotta kill Joker. Gotta that Superman guy too.
Gotta take that dude out. Gotta teach that dude a lesson.
And it could be, and I'd say that as a joke, but also because like it could be like that whimsical. Like that's the dark side of Batman is he's super rich. He can do anything. He's a rich libertarian.
Right.
So he can waste all his resources on really whatever strikes his fancy.
Right.
That's the kind of underlying scary part about drinking the Batman Kool-Aid, I will say, so to speak.
Yeah, no, I think, I think we'll have to, I'll go ahead and tease episode 8 for us where we're, since in honor of or in light of the wonderful American election barreling down on most of our listeners out in podcast land, the wonderful choice you have to make for us, the rest of the world. I'm part of it too. Hey, ladies, I voted from ladies and gentlemen, I'm still an American citizen. I voted a month ago. From a distance, we will be doing we're going to go ahead and crack into a little superhero in politics using this as sort of a springboard. But yeah, it's Frank Miller's a creep, and I think Frank is gonna make a rather large appearance next week as well. You can't argue that Frank doesn't, especially after Dark Knight One, with Give Me Liberty, with 300, and definitely eventually in Sin City, and then the book that's really the hot button issue for most people, Holy Terror, which I never bothered to read. He drags his politics directly into his work. But that doesn't mean that superheroes still didn't start out as sort of, kind of crazy, interesting libertarian fantasies. That's my quote-unquote issue, but whatever. Do you have a particular issue, any other issues with Mr. Miller that you can jump into here in our final segment?
Again, we might go into this a later date, but, it is worth mentioning. Yeah, he's a problematic figure. He goes pretty crazy at one point, and... can we just start, say, like sort of spouting off on the hippies, the Occupy movement, the people who we kind of thought he was on our side before?
I'll let the cat out of the bag on that one. It gobsmacked me that when, I'll get more into what my history with that is. Next week, but it when that dropped, I just had to pick my jaw up off the floor. I was so confused. And I think again we'll unpack it a little bit more next week. And not that we're going to speak for Frank Miller in any way, shape, or form. It floored me. Floored the living crap out of me.
Yeah, I mean, because we say like. It's just very interesting. Yeah, I can't find any words either. The ultra violence and the ultra, let's just say whimsy of Batman does kind of become a problem in his later works, future works after Dark Knight Returns. And one thing, Dark Knight Returns works in a really good way because it's it's framed with the Cold War.
Right. Yes.
Right. And as a piece of its time, it kind of makes sense in that kind of heavy oppositional, you know, U.S. versus Soviet thing. Mm-hmm. And then when we move past the Cold War to different kinds of threats, I don't know, maybe Miller just started interpreting those threats differently.
That's an interesting thought. Yeah, and, maybe we'll try to unpack that again next week. That makes sense. Okay. You got another thought there? What's that? It's kicking around inside your head. I can see it.
I was trying to summon something about the Nolan films that was succinct, but.
Oof. Here's my summing up of the Nolan films.
Yeah.
Fuck you, Christopher Nolan, for turning Batman into a cop by the end. Right, that was the end. That was the on the other end of things, Batman completely into a tool of the establishment, where he's literally at the front, leading an army of policemen. To me, such an antithesis of what that character is about. Any version of that character. I really truly just ended up despising where that series landed. That third movie is so confused in its politics, in its message, in its and again, it doesn't have to be a message movie, but again, Dom, as you guys know, Dom and I are very interested in deep structure and things like that.
Right.
Its deep structure is so flawed as to be impossible to impossible to interpret. It's it's not intentional. It's all mistake.
It's just kind of random.
And it's just it's a pile of random. It's a pile
and
of random.
And no, I mean, on a you know, like another thing that works in Dark Knight Returns, that moment sort of happens again, but I remember Batman. He's not leading the cops. He's formed his own break-off splinter group of the young punks.
Yes.
To go battle the other young punks.
Exactly.
So it's just different factions of the young punks. He rides in on the horseback after telling them, no, we're not using guns because they fucking hate guns.
Yep.
That's how that moment plays out in Dark Knight.
Which is a real different image than fucking Batman leading a fucking group of cops to come in to fight the terrorists. Like, I mean...
That was...
Fuck me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Difficult, messed up.
Anywho.
Yeah.
I mean, so we usually go to a small segment called Final Thoughts, but I think those are all our final thoughts there. I mean, outside of... just want to wrap up for me. Again, we talked a bit of shit there at the end, but you know, there is no, as far as I'm concerned, there is no overstating the effect that Frank Miller had on modern comics. On if you like anything about what's going on in the comics world, if you like anything that's going on with comic books being transitioned into movies, you need to go. You need to spend a couple of psychic moments sending that dude some vibes, regardless of his politics, regardless of whatever, because bedrock. You know, as far as I'm concerned, again, Chris Claremont's run on the Uncanny X-Men, Frank Miller, Alan Moore comes butting in with starts on the Swamp Thing, but obviously peaks at the Watchmen, and V for Vendetta, and then Grant Morrison comes in to sort of make it all meta. You've got to. A lot of this falls apart without Frank Miller, Frank Miller's work. So, ladies and gentlemen, we always end with our last little bit where we tell you what we're working on. Dom, what you got going down?
Well, I'm gonna do National Novel Writing Month.
You're doing I always mispronounce this. Namo Romo.
I got it wrong the first time. I believe NaNoWriMo.
NaNoWriMo, that's what it is. Sorry.
Right, is elated. All of them are elated. Yeah. Anyway, you know, I'm cheating a bit because it's a novel I started and have some parts of, but
that's
the point
cheating.
Is to get a novel. It's not start from word one.
Yeah.
Great. So, yeah, hopefully I'm going to try to be disciplined about it, and hopefully at the end of this month I'll have the draft of a novel.
Excellent.
A fun novel, not like an annoying, pretentious Who Am I novel. It's going to be a fun novel.
It's going to be a fun one. All right, fantastic. Great. That's awesome. Continue to plug away at the feature film out here. We're hearing from might hear from a couple of editors very soon. Some lady editors we've approached and given the script to. We're very excited to see who comes back and is excited about the project. We're keeping that. We're crewing up. It's November. We're shooting in January. I am crapping my pants with fear and anticipation. Every morning I wake up and I'm just like, what do I have to do today? I have to and then I go and I do my writing, which is a sort of a speed journal thing where I do what I call morning pages, 3 pages where I just dump, and that's where all my anxiety lives in a little notebook, and it focuses me down, which is great. And I've just started to really now, like I said at the beginning, I've gone back to my Asian cinema to sort of like, I'm really starting to envision the look of this thing, and that's getting really, really exciting. I booked my ticket for my DP, we have a wonderful DP named Gabby Norlin, who is out of London. Just booked her ticket to come over, and we're all going to go do a walkthrough of the space next week, and really get the look of this thing starting to down.
And just be clear, where is it mainly shooting?
It's shooting in Brussels, 100% in Brussels. Okay. We're shooting all in Brussels in one location in a church, chapel called Marie le Miserable. So there you go. So that's great. Thank you guys so much. Remember, if you like us or love us, please leave us a review on iTunes. It helps people find us. We do have the Facebook page as well, of course, at Elevating the Genre on Facebook. There's the YouTube stuff where you get to see our wonderful, shiny, beautiful faces. Always comment, like, subscribe. It really helps us out. And as always, we appreciate you. And we did it, Tom. Look, we're under an hour and 10 minutes. I'm very proud of us.
We're trying to streamline this for you folks.
For you folks.
Thanks everyone who's born with our 90-minute episodes.
Yes, we will reserve those for special occasions from now on. But thanks so much, ladies and gentlemen. We have been Elevating the Genre. Christopher saying goodbye, and
I am goddamn Dominic.
Goddamn Dominic.
That's a little Frank Miller thing for those.
All right, goddamn it. Cheers, ladies and gentlemen. Have a good day. Bye. Attractive face things. That's going to be the intro for this week's podcast. Thank you.